Welcome to NTN Nightly. I am Janelle Novel. This edition's top stories. The Ministries of Education and Infrastructure to build new additions to two schools that will also serve as emergency shelters. The National Workers Union applauds government's efforts to reopen the economy. And Alicat makes a universal connection at 18. The Ministries of Education and Infrastructure have collaborated on a project to upgrade two schools in the Castries Basin. Upon completion, the schools will serve as shelters during times of disaster and emergency situations. Hermody Mark reports on the plans for the new school buildings at the Gordon and Walcott Memorial School and the Vidbute Primary School.
A contract signing ceremony was held between Construction and Industrial Equipment Limited, Prudy's Construction, and the Government of St. Lucia. This signaled the commencement of works to improve the infrastructure of two schools in the Castries Basin. The purpose of the new wings at the Gordon and Walcott Methodist and Vidbute Primary Schools is to provide a conducive environment for students and teachers. Michelle Charles is the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Education, Innovation, Gender Relations, and Sustainable Development.
For us, it is more than just concrete classrooms and furniture, but most importantly, it is about the kind of future we can create for our country, starting with our little ones. It's about giving students and teachers alike a reason to wake up and go to school on the morning. It's about creating a safe space for our students who may not otherwise feel safe elsewhere.
An important consideration being made in the design of the schools is the ability for their use as shelters during a disaster and emergency situations. Honorable Dr. Gail Rigobert, Minister for Education, Innovation, Gender Relations and Sustainable Development, explains that the existing structures will be transformed to smart schools.
For us, education is certainly more than fine buildings. Education is more than smart schools. And my colleagues are already beginning to smile behind their masks, because when we say smart schools, we mean schools that reflect a fine-tuned understanding of multiple intelligences and the need to cater for children who are differently abled and who are superlatively intelligent. We recognize, too, when we speak of smart schools, we speak of the infusion of technology. We speak of the need to embrace renewable energy. We speak of the dual purpose that many of our schools on island serve, which is that not only do they serve an educational function, but many of them are also emergency shelters, and that therefore compels us more than ever to ensure that they are also climate resilient.
Minister for External Affairs and Parliamentary Representative for Castries Central, Honorable Sarah Flood Bobre, noted the importance of a conducive environment to learning.
Housing affects almost every aspect of life. It affects health, it affects education, it affects overall well-being. Poor housing leads to abuse of children and families. You simply can't raise healthy families if there is poor housing. And what does housing have to do with what I'm talking about here today? A school needs a home. Schools need good housing. And we've known for so many years and decades, in fact, that we have excellent teachers, that we have a people that are on par or perhaps even excel many others. I mean, we are well known for having per capita the world's highest number of Nobel laureates.
The works within this project for Vidbute Primary School comprises of the new construction of a three-level reinforced concrete building consisting of a total floor space of 13,571 square feet of teaching and administrative space. The lot of the Vidbute School is 43,044 square feet, which will accommodate the new structure. The works at the Gordon and Walcott Methodist will consist of a two-level reinforced concrete structure. The site works will include improvements in the perimeter fencing, improved vehicular parking conditions, and improved site access on the northern boundary, and a refurbishing of the existing septic tank. Honourable Stevenson King, Minister for Infrastructure, Ports, Energy and Labour, and Parliamentary Representative for Castries North, said one issue he hopes will be remedied at the Methodist school is the port drainage system.
There's one issue at the Methodist school, and that is the issue of the drain which runs through the compound of the Methodist school. And I recall many years going to attending Methodist school, and Reno will remember, how that playground flooded and we were marooned as a consequence of the inability to get out unless your parent had a vehicle capable of navigating through the flooded playground. I would hope that at some stage, probably in conjunction with the Ministry of Infrastructure, that we can address that situation if it is not yet considered in the design for the construction of the Methodist school.
The plans include improvement of the drainage system for both schools. From the Government Information Service, I'm Humadi Mark.
The St. Lucia Electoral Department has heightened operations in preparation for the 2021 general elections, constitutionally due in October. The department has launched a registration mobile unit to assist citizens in ensuring they exercise their franchise.
Voter registration is very important in that it is considered the first step in the process that allows an individual to exercise their franchise. The registration process is free and is described as permanent, continuous, and personal. A person is qualifying to be registered as an elector in an electoral district only if on the qualifying date the individual is a citizen of St. Lucia or a Commonwealth citizen residing continuously in St. Lucia for not less than 7 years immediately preceding the qualifying date. The individual has attained 18 years of age and has resided continuously in that electoral district for a period of at least 2 months preceding the qualifying date. Assistant Chief Elections Officer in the St. Lucia Electoral Department, Olympia Lionel, indicated that the Electoral Department has intensified its efforts to ensure all individuals are afforded the opportunity to register and thus exercise their franchise.
This year, because of COVID, we extended our services beyond. We have a number of outdoor centers where we have continuous registration in those centers, open Monday to Friday. We also implemented a mobile service where we will go into the various communities, like constituencies, for the weekends. We will go into the various constituencies. Right now we are in Brazil. And what we are doing that to achieve, we find sometimes during the election period, persons with the last minute to come and register. And to avoid all of that, we have extended our services in the various communities and established those centers there from September. They had been established, one in Denry North, one in Sufre, and one in Brazili. So we have those ads running every day to let persons know where we located, our numbers, and what they need to register.
The annual qualifying dates are the 15th of February in respect of the first half of the year and the 15th of July in respect of the second half of the year. For nationals to obtain the new national identification card, they must provide their birth certificate and a letter from the National Insurance Corporation, NIC, while non-nationals must provide their birth certificate, a letter from the NIC, and the certificate of citizenship from the Ministry of Home Affairs. To effect a change of address, an individual must provide their identification card and utility bills for at least 3 months prior to the application for change as proof of address. A verification of the residence will be carried out by a verification team. To effect a change of name, the individual must provide the national ID, a letter from the NIC, and the original document showing change of name, that is their birth certificate, marriage certificate, deed poll, or affidavit. The Electoral Department explained provisions made to aid in replacing lost or stolen ID cards.
We understand persons' bags have been stolen, and that's Electoral has implemented every year. That's our way of assisting. We actually waiver the fee of the $100 during International Democracy Month, which is September. And it has become a pattern because St. Lucians are actually looking forward And last year, because we were coming into this election year, we had extended it to at least 3 months. Because you find a lot of persons are coming in to say they misplaced their bags, etc. But you also have persons that is 70 years and over, which is, they can be exempted. The chief elections officer have that kind of power to exempt them. You have persons now coming with the government cards. They are unable to work. They have disabilities. Once you can give us the proof, you are exempted if your card is stolen.
Yeah, and also a police report would exempt you as well from paying the fees. Yeah.
Once registered, an individual is placed on the voters list. The registration remains in force unless there is a valid cause for cancellation, such as death or migration, and the prospective registrant must apply in person to the registration officers if the registration is to be effected. No person can apply for registration on behalf of another person. It also provides for the issue of an identification card to the registrant when the registration is effected. From the Government Information Service, I am Janelle Norville.
The National Workers Union, NWU, has endorsed what it says are the bold initiatives currently being undertaken by the government of St. Lucia in the gradual opening up of the tourism sector. The Cabinet of Ministers, on the advice of the Chief Medical Officer, approved amendments to the COVID-19 Prevention and Control Regulations that came into effect the 31st of May 2021 to the 30th of June 2021. The amendments included an adjustment for fully vaccinated individuals, returning nationals and visitors with a negative PCR test and who are fully vaccinated and now not required to quarantine. Deputy President General of the NWU, Solis Myers, says the measure facilitates the reopening of businesses in the tourism sector.
We represent a number of members in the tourism industry. We have a number of hotel employer partners. So we would have been placed strategically, if you will, to actually witness all of the implications of COVID-19 from March last year in terms of the closures, the toll on the workers, the psychological impact, the financial impact, also on the employers as well. So we were very, very concerned in terms of the future of the industry. And, you know, the impact in terms of the workers, where they will be placed, etc. So with the announcement that the government is going in that direction, the union endorses these bold initiatives because we see the positive impact in terms of trying to get people back at work, trying to make sure everybody is able to recover as much as possible as a result of this pandemic, because it has not been easy on any sector.
The NWU advises that while efforts are being made by the relevant authorities to ensure gainful employment is resumed by the tens of thousands of workers in that sector, all workers need to be mindful that in the current COVID-19 environment, there is a dire need to protect themselves, their families, and the general public. Director of the Pan American Health Organization, Dr. Carissa Etienne, has called on political leaders in the region to put aside rhetoric and unite to combat the coronavirus. Dr. Etienne made the plea as she warned that COVID-19 cases and deaths have begun rising in Central and South America and the Caribbean after plateauing or decreasing for weeks.
Since the start of the new year, we have seen a rapid increase in infections. In just the first 5 months of 2021, both cases and deaths have almost doubled in the region. Wishful thinking will not solve or resolve this crisis. We need action. So please let me remind you of what needs to be done to stop this outbreak. The first thing is effective leadership. This pandemic has taught us time and again that leadership determines the effectiveness of a country's response. Sadly, across our region, we've seen misinformation about COVID-19, and this has sown the doubt on proven health measures and often in the context of political disputes. By stoking controversy where there is none, our leaders are sending mixed messages to the public and are standing in the way of effective measures to control the virus. We must unite around stopping this virus, and this should be the first priority.
Central America is reporting the highest number of deaths. Infections are increasing in Panama, Belize, and El Salvador, where new cases have doubled in the last 7 days. In South America, Colombia is reporting the highest rate of infections in South America. Brazil is also seeing a rise in new infections and hospitalizations. Uruguay, Argentina, and Chile continue to report a rise in cases. Many Caribbean islands, including Dutch St. Martin, Trinidad and Tobago, and the Dominican Republic, are reporting a surge in infections. Dr. Etienne says the region needs an urgent access to vaccines.
Effective vaccines are a beacon of hope in this crisis, and we must do all in our power to secure more doses for all nations in the Americas. We are very far from this goal, especially for the low-income countries that are still struggling to protect health professionals and those more vulnerable. COVAX has already delivered some 17.6 million doses to our region, but progress is not keeping up with the pandemic. Regional solidarity, including the donation of doses, will be key to get us through the current shortage of supply. Vaccine will save lives and prevent future waves. But for the current surge in infections, we have to deploy the tools that we have at hand.
Those tools, the PAHO director reminded, are the simple but effective public health practices of washing hands, sanitizing, and social distancing. A vexing situation at the St. Jude Hospital involving conditions in the kitchen cafeteria has been resolved. Chairman of the board, Wayne Harrow, has confirmed that staff of the department protested flooding in the kitchen, however informed that the situation was resolved once brought to the attention of senior management. The water in the department, Mr. Harrow says, was as a result of leakage in the pipelines.
As soon as the excess water was identified on the floor, I am informed by management that everything was done to clean up and to remedy and to fix the plumbing system. Everything is back to normal. In terms of the issue of the patients not being fed breakfast, they were in fact fed. It was done late because of the existing situation that was remedied.
Mr. Harrow says despite best efforts by management, such infrastructure issues do arise.
There are occasional situations with the plumbing system at the hospital. At no time did management deliberately neglect their responsibilities to put staff in the way of danger. As soon as the issue was brought to the attention of senior management, it was dealt with expeditiously. I wish to apologize on behalf of management and the board to the staff members who felt that there was some degree of neglect. That was not the case, and that is not the case. It will never be the case. Our maintenance team will remain on track to ensure that in the future, those minor glitches are dealt with quickly.
Staff of the kitchen and cafeteria resumed duty hours after downing their tools. Nikki Edmonds, better known by her Calypsonian name Alicat, has continued producing music despite the pandemic. She has teamed up with a local music producer, Kelly Indigo, to produce 18 songs that she hopes will inspire and give hope to persons who truly listen to her music. The duo, who goes by the name The Universal Connection, has also received moral and financial support from the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association, who encourages its members like Nikki to push the envelope and set no limits on themselves and their creativity. Glenn Simon reports.
There you go again, switching up on me. Like you wanna train on my energy.
My name is Nikki Allison Edmonds, aka Ali Katz.
Nikki Alicat Edmonds is living proof that COVID can't lock up talents or dreams. Alongside her producer, Kevin Kelly Indigo Monrose, they have since May 17th, 2021, produced and released 12 of the 18 songs which they have been working on.
It's been a very interesting and trying, 5 months, but we have made it through thus far and I'm very grateful. I wouldn't have it any other way.
Nikki's talents are not only featured in the vocals in the music, but also in the musical arrangement, as she is a proficient keyboard player, a skill she credits to her early involvement with the St. Lucia Blind Welfare Association, of which she is both a member and client, having been diagnosed with low vision from an early age.
With this current project, the Blind Welfare Association did assist in us being able to get a bass guitar added to the regime of instruments.
Alicat said persons should stop setting limitations on blind and low vision individuals, as this only helps to diminish their self-esteem and impede their personal growth and development.
I just want to reiterate to my fellow blind and visually impaired brothers and sisters out there and to the sighted community also that it's all up to you. You know, you have to know what you want and you have to go for it, and you'll attract people and circumstances to actually make that happen.
Nikki and her producer Kevin Monroes, who goes by the sobriquet Kelly Indigo, created their melodious music from his home-based studio called Psych Sound Studio. The duo goes by the name The Universal Connection.
We have a wonderful working relationship and I love that. We're comfortable with each other. He does not look at my visual impairment as anything but normal.
Like, it's just an awesome vibe working with her, and I really value it because, like, she's always so, like you just said, you know, always wants to keep going, and that's the kind of energy that I want around me, you know, because when that's going on, I as an individual as well can grow, and then we could grow together, we could be on the same page.
Their music is currently available on YouTube at The Universal Connection and Kelly Indigo. Nikki is hopeful that her music will touch and inspire persons who take time to listen.
I want for people to feel joy and happiness when they hear the music, because there are so many people who are hopeless, who feel depressed, who feel lost because of everything that's going on, coupled with their own issues, independent of this COVID virus. I want the music to penetrate people's hearts and to actually just align them with something brilliant.
She ended the interview by singing her favorite track on the album, entitled Switching Up On Me. Glenn Simon reporting.
This is NTN Nightly. Up next, Primus Hutchinson with the NTN Nouvelle Akweyol.
Here at St. Lucia Distillers, we produce an award-winning range of rums and rum products. We export our rums to the Caribbean, North America, and Europe. Standards facilitate our entry into overseas markets. In the rum business, it is critical that our distillers and blenders get it right. St. Lucia Distillers is HACCP certified. We use two standards from SLBS, the standard for labeling of pre-packaged foods, SLNS 1-3/2014, and the National Specification for Rum, SLNS 12-2003. We are also a registered member of the West Indies Rum and Spirit Producers Association, WISPER. SLBS ensures that we are up to standard and world class.
This message is brought to you by the Commonwealth Standards Network.
Welcome back. We join Primus Hutchinson for the NTN Nouvelle Akweyol.
Merci autant, General. Monsieur, Madame, Département, qui nous responsabilité pour formation, gouvernement, c'est le GIS, et puis Television National Paya NTN, Kapuseto Nouvelle, A Creole, Kapuseto Primus Hutchinson. Minister des Affaires Construction et Travaux, j'avais permission pour compagnie Overseas Engineering Construction, Hod Taiwan, pour commencer à bâtir grand projet la tournée à Sushime Union qui est estimé pour coûter 1,7 million de dollars et pas 5 millions de dollars qu'on qui sorti à son rapport en cette section média pays. Projet pour établir un grand la tournée en Union qui a formé un plus gros projet de réhabilitation grand chemin Marisil, Grand Rivière et Union. Projet ça là qui a fait par trois différents composants côté compagnie Sir Williams engagé et puis section Marcel pour Grand Rivière et des gazons, Construction and Industrial Equipment engagé et puis un plus haut chemin Postlewit pour section des gazons, Excalis Construction Services Limited, West Coast Sab pour Grand Latourne en Union. Ministère a informé le public là qui projet a adressé problème côté l'auto qui a comblé et affecté habilité pour trafic là courir plus facilement. Haute activité à l'école première de Mpelet, et c'est l'autre établissement commercial qui prie. Projet aussi qu'a embrassé un placement neuf pour les parents et l'auto déposé et amassé les étudiants à l'école première de Mpelet. Projet qu'a complémenté par une ligne chemin qui a ajouté pour faciliter le mouvement trafic qui n'a pas agorgé trafic qui a entré seulement à l'école là et l'autre activité qui a même levé en masala, tout ça a fait, et puis plusieurs consultations, et puis l'école la même, avec l'autre agence qui a même place là. Chimé Postlewit, et côté il a branché, et puis grand chimé Alan Bousquet, j'ai posé un pile trois cassements pour ni les chauffeurs et les gens qui ont servi. Et pour raison ça, le projet a établi plusieurs façons de protection, par exemple, trottoir, signe, ça c'est signe trafic, place pour attendre l'auto passager en parmi l'autre. Le ministère des Affaires de Construction et Travaux qui a encouragé le public là pour faire contact et puis yo pour empêcher pièces d'information qui ne doivent pas être parce que ça ne va pas apporter justice pour le public. Quand le pays s'est laissé continuer pour faire bataille et essayer de vivre en bas de pèse maladie corona, les amis et c'est l'âme bon charitable à l'autre pays, grand pays, qui a longé la main pour cette lycée, et particulièrement les plus grands citoyens. Les plus grands citoyens cette lycée qui ont resté en institution, qui ont responsable pour l'occupation, j'ai reçu plusieurs articles et équipements médicaux pour les habitants pays à cette lycée, aussi station radio qui a porté nous en Watch, en New York. Ils ont tous collaboré pour faire possible. Pour ces plus grands citoyens, ça a reçu divers articles. Parmi ça, a reçu ces chaises à roule. Cette institution qui est responsable pour occuper les plus grands citoyens trouver bénéfice ça là. C'est l'ambassade qui est responsable pour affaires les habitants cette ici qui est l'autre pays. Ça c'est Dr. Joycelyn Fletcher qui fait l'initiative ça là possible. Selon Dr. Fletcher, c'était un grand plaisir pour que ça fait une initiative comme ça venir en réalité. Dr. Fletcher a renforcé gratitude pour des grandes assistances des citoyens qui vivent à l'autre pays, qui continuent à bailler la famille et l'autre qui plient les voisins en cette même depuis après la maladie du corona attaqué le pays. L'ambassade a mentionné la quantité de boîtes et de barres, commission, articles, équipements, l'argent, tous les semaines, qui ont entré par Western Union. En parmi plusieurs autres assistances, hors des citoyens qui ont resté à l'autre grand pays. Ambassade Dr. Fletcher déclaré qui lit ensemble avec le gouvernement cette ici et le peuple pays même généralement yo très appréciable pour ces degrés assistance là qui cette ici l'autre pays j'ai fait et le peuple pays a continué à recevoir institution pour développement social à cette ici SSDF et assistance là pour de faciliter quoi effort ça là un représentatif à ces institutions ça là aussi offert appréciation. Parmi ces institutions qui trouvaient assistance, c'est St. Lucy's Home, Marian Home, Cornerstone, Mission of Charity, Villa St. Joseph. Representative Kai Palama po Sofia ek for Sejak onewa Harold Stanislas ka kweki magwe ipe poyon tita pou tout awajman vini a plas etiema jabouton ka sa trouve tit pou se te wenki yo ka bite asu pou se telman lontan. Recentman, representative pou Sofia ek for Sejak la fè yon anonsman ki la jani diskisyon epi le pwet ek la pawes ek l'Eglise Katolike Setlisi pou gade a posibilite pou le resident a komin bouton touve tit pou se tewen ki yo asou pou sietan. Silon ane wap Harold Stanislas, magwe negosyasyon kadi kaidiwe pou pli kon pou yon de mwa a la fin se yon ki kay an gwa benefis pou jan bouton.
Pendant la guerre, ça c'est dans une semaine, deux semaines. Mais dans une des les autres mois encore, nous avons pour la guerre, ça a arrangement. Ça fait, nous savons à partir de ce là, à commencer à partir de la base de là, et puis pour enregistrer c'est l'autre là, et puis pour nous avoir ce monde là. Donc ça c'est dans la guerre, une des semaines, et puis une des mois en permanence pour faire.
Ak mwen asywe ki chay se moun nan ki teja kite bouton ay weste lot kote exake lot peyi kay pren avantay kon afè sa la.
Asywe man, paske komo do bouton sa bel ti plas, la fwe, la ni bel view, la meyo piton, bel plas.
Ak mwen se vedam, sa se kote nou atro bout nou fal la pou chodia, mwen kaj mwen se otan pou ka kote, pou ka gade, ek mwen kaba ou yon invitasyon pou chodia pi mwen akor. C'est dire qu'on s'est fait la vie de mon gars pour cette nouvelle à Koyol. Je vous souhaite tout le monde un bon finissement de semaine et que ça soit mon vie pour cette Chanel.
Merci, Apple Primus. And that brings us to the end of NTN Nightly. Join us next time at 7 p.m. with a repeat at 7 a.m. You can also catch up with us anytime on the St. Lucia Government Facebook page or YouTube channel. I am Chanel Norville.